So, here we are again, friends, with a small vlog on core issues of Buddhist philosophy. And this time it is a central core concept of the five clusters of clinging, the five aggregates, the five groups that make up all individual existence. So the five khandas, the five clusters, the five aggregates, what are they? They are one form, this thing and that thing out there. Feeling, number two. Number three, perception, sanya. And number four, mental construction, sankhara. And number five, vijnana, consciousness. So form, rupa. Feeling, vedana. Perception, sanya. Mental construction, sankhara. Consciousness, vijnana. That's, according to Buddhist philosophy, what makes up the individual stream of being. So there's no ego, self, me, mine, what I am, what I'm made of, inside these five clusters of being. No, outside them. These five clusters of being are just things that come and go. They are momentary and thereby very dynamic because they change all the time from one moment to the next moment. Yes, an ant, little digger that digged a huge hole here to get out the small ant larvae. Humongous hole. Good job, good digging. But the ants probably don't think so. They thought they were safe underground. Like human thinks they are safe underground. But neither is the case. Nevertheless, back to these five clusters of clinging. They are suffering because, by definition, because they are impermanent. So one cannot trust them, one cannot trust one's form, one cannot trust one's feeling, one cannot trust one's perception, mental construction and consciousness. Why not? Because one cannot keep it. In the case it is likable, then one cannot keep it. Not even for a moment. So indeed they are not trustable. Nevertheless, they are what we cling to. And since we cling to something that we inevitably loses all the time, in each moment, then it causes suffering. Because when you lose whatever you cling to, then you feel panic, despair, sorrow, fear. Whatever it's like is going away. Or it is becoming otherwise. So this causes suffering. This is as such not the form, the feeling, the perception, the mental construction and consciousness itself that is suffering. It is the clinging to them that makes them become suffering. Insofar as the Arahat, the awakened being and whoever momentarily experiences this release, that they do not cling to form, they do not cling to feeling, they do not cling to perception, they do not cling to mental construction, nor do they cling to consciousness. Well, then when they go away, change or become otherwise, there's no panic there. So be it. It comes and it goes. It comes again and goes again. It comes again and goes again. So what? It has always done so. And this emboldens the mind to a much more solid calm that is not affected by all these circumstances of bushes, trees, dictators, changing political parties, histories, moral decay, and what have you, of change in this world. It doesn't become sorrowed or saddened by these changes. Why so? Because it didn't expect this mind, this very realistic mind, it didn't expect these things to be lasting anyway. As Sisyphus has for a long time entertained this reflection on these five clusters as claimed, as serial killers, as something dangerous, as something disgusting, as something repulsive, then it doesn't cling to it. Let's go. Bye-bye, body. Becoming sick. Bye-bye, die. Don't come back. Same with feeling. All experience, perception, all hopes, intentions in the form of mental construction or no consciousness, whether visual, auditory, or gustatory. They're just momentary. So the mind can let them go without feeling so. Is that easy? No. Is it possible? Yes, indeed it is possible. Indeed it is possible. And that's the way, you know. That's the way. The noble way. The goal of the noble way is to be able to let these five clusters of being arise and cease there on the very spot where they arise, without clinging to them, without wanting them back. Any leopards here? No. Without longing back to them in foolish nostalgia, without dreaming about them in equally folly, unrealistic hoping for what has yet to come. The Buddha likened these five clusters of clinging to five serial killers. They follow you like five killers with their sword up in the air, like this. They have a sword, huh? And so he said the being who has not established awareness, he's like a man with a bowl of full of oil on his head that is full to the brim, so a crowd could drink from it. And then he has to go into a crowd where the beauty queen is dancing. And the moment he spills one drop of oil, chop! Then they chop off his head. These serial killers. It is to this extent, as acute as that, that one should watch these five things arise and cease. Arise and cease, right where they arise. So now I take a step. It's not the same foot that goes forward that puts down. The foot that the material state that put the foot forward, it went down there as another thing. Same thing, this hand here. It's not the same as this hand here. There's gonna 100,000 billions of billions of billions of billions Planck moments, material states arising and ceasing since the hand went from here to there. So, everything is re-arising, existing itself, both the mental part of it, the conscious part of it, and the material part of it is blinking. It is discrete, discontinuous, arising and ceasing, endlessly. That the Buddha spoke about that, the quantum of time, discreteness of time. Do. it's impressive because to when you come to see the rising and ceasing, each single moment of it, then one has established this hyper-acute awareness. In the beginning, one will see it as vibration. One cannot fully grasp the single moment, but one will first one can see gross change. You can see change here in the facial expression on my face. You can see change here in trees passing. But you cannot see the single moment. So it starts with change. Then deeper down, one can see the change hyperacute. Deeper down, it can see as vibration, ultra fast vibration. Deeper down, shorter time scales, one can see the single event, the single Dhamma arise and the single Dhamma cease. There's my cherry camera. Gotta pick it up, see if there's any leopard on it or other interesting sentient beings. Also, considering their particular individual stream, discontinuous blinking stream of form, feeling, perception, mental construction, and consciousness. In short, these five clusters of clinging, even shorter in the form of one big bunch of suffering. This actually requires going to Nibbana, because Nibbana is outside, not included in the world, and thereby not included in what is changing, impermanent, under the spell of time passing. Block. So we turn around. That being so, then it leaves up only one alternative, actually, because now we have defined another animal track up the hill. Now we have defined the purpose of all life as reaching lasting happiness. And we also have nailed down with absolute certainty that this lasting happiness is only to be found in the state called Nibbana. Only. And so, well, how to reach Nibbana? Is one way or many ways? There's one way. Ikkayana Maggo. And this is a noble eightfold way. Arya Attangika Mantra. And nothing else than that. And what is the noble eightfold way? It is right view, Sammaditti, right motivation, right speech, Sammavacca, right action, Sammakamanta. Right livelihood, Sammajiva. Right effort. Samma vajama. Right awareness. Even when you're going on muddy, very steep slopes in the jungle. Samma sati. And right concentration. Samma samadhi. That's a noble eightfold way that leads gradually to nirvana. And how does it succeed in leading the individual stream of consciousness to this state of nirvana? This lasting, non-changing state of deathless happiness and peace. How can it do that? It can do that by decoupling the clinging to these five clusters of clinging. How do you decouple clinging? Yeah, what's the cause of clinging? Craving is the cause of clinging. So if one doesn't crave for a given phenomenon, then one doesn't cling to it either. Sure thing. So this means that detaching, releasing these five clusters of clinging entails not craving for them. If you have habitually craved for a lot of things, for example, form, sexual craving is craving for somebody else's form, their body. Craving after feeling is only like pleasant feeling of the mind, happiness, gladness, pleasant feeling of the body, for example, orgasm, or feeling full after having eaten, or cozy after when sleeping, pleasant feeling, or painful feeling, craving away from painful feeling of the body, pee in the, or tooth pain, or headache, or something like that, or painful feeling in the mind, mental painful feeling, depression, feeling sad, feeling sorrow, sadness, and then this neutral feeling. So it's not craving for these things or away from them. Then one doesn't cling to the cluster of clinging that is feeling, vedana. Then one doesn't cling to one's own body or somebody else's body or the forms and colors of the world. Then one doesn't cling to form. If one doesn't cling to perceptions, experiences, whether visual perception, auditory perception, sound. Visual perception is all sights, whether real or not, whether in the cinema or in the forest. All experience of taste, wrong path, big spider. Wrong experience of taste, or experience of taste, experience of smell. Anything that goes with eating. Mental states also, experience of mental states. Touch, experience of touch. All that is perception. Experience of touch is, for example, a major driving force. Experience of touch on the genitals and on the lips and on the hands is a major driving force for sexual craving, whether aroused by porn or the real stuff. Right path. Nice three root there, very large one. Oops. Root. The root of craving is feeling. So, if not craving for any perception, one doesn't cling to any experience, and thereby not any perception. One doesn't cling to that. One has released that, all experiences. Then, well, then one doesn't cling to that aspect. And the Buddha, he once should go and see to a sick monk who was lying, dying. And in order to gauge him, to measure him, how far he was on his path, then he asked him the following questions. Well, friend, is there anything you want to see? No. Is there anything that you still want to hear? No. Answered the sick monk. Is there anything you still want to taste, smell, touch? No. Is there anything you want to, any mental state, thought, that you still want to think, or any mental state that you want to attain? No. Ah, very well, monk. You are released. And so the monk died, and when the monk had died, then Buddha explained that he died a blameless death because he actually was awakened either a little before or during the process of dying itself. So he didn't come back to have more craving and thereby clinging to something that is basically suffering because it doesn't last. You can ask yourself, try to be brutally honest here. Is there something I still want to see? Is there something I still want to hear? Something I still want to taste, touch, experience? If that's the case, well, then there is a lack of realization that whatever it is that you want, then that very thing is suffering. So this is, of course, a lack of wisdom and understanding. I think there's a deer here inside the bush, or something else. Could also be a wild boar. Just stay still. So do I. Not bothering each other. No need to bother others. No need. Very close to here. Another entrance. Have a nice day. Or whatever you are. So since we have habitually, both as animals, as devas, as ghosts, or as human beings, in all our prior existences, then we have gained momentary happiness and in the form of pleasure, and also momentary pain and frustration from all these captivating, interesting, beautiful, colorful, interesting, tantalizing phenomena of this world. And because we have experienced that, then we keep craving for it or away from it. Since we crave for it, since we crave for form, for feeling, for perception, for mental construction, and for consciousness, since we crave for that, well, then there's clinging. And this means, since there's this clinging, there will also be becoming. Since there's becoming, there will be birth. Rebirth in any moment, and thereby also in the moment of death. When there's birth, then there's also aging, sickness, decay, and death. When there's aging, sickness, decay, and death of the moment, of the body, of the individual, and of the life, of the entire universe, well, then there is suffering, indeed so. so. This clinging is the motor. It's the driving force behind the development, behind the dynamics of the process, momentary process of one conscious moment ceasing and the next one arising immediately after. From one material moment ceasing and the next one arising immediately after. That's not the case for the Arahant, because the Arahant doesn't cling. And that means that when his prior clinging, traces of clinging, probability traces of clinging has gone, his karmic accumulation goes to zero, pure zero, then there is no driving force for becoming. Oh, worship. And this means that when he dies, then he will not be reborn. He goes scot-free. He attains the state of Nibbana without any trace of clinging left. Nibbana anupadisesa. While if he was enlightened before death, then he had attained the state of Nibbana with traces of clinging left, namely Nibbana sa upadisesa. So much for the five clusters of clinging. Their relinquishment and the consequences hereof. Namo Tassa Bhagavato Arahato Sammasambuddhassa. And may you have a nice day.